question of overdrive, I'm so in need that. Now, when we talk of full-blown SUVs, the Toyota Fortuner very naturally comes to mind first. It's not only because it's a very capable off-roader or has a large fan base, it's also because it symbolizes power as well as authority. And for the longest time, the Ford Endeavor was its only true challenger in the market. But now Mahindra has entered that segment with the Alturas, and we decided to pit the two against each other just to see which one ranks on top.
SUVs probably don't get more real than this. The Fortuner and Alturas are both big and imposing looking, and both boast lots of road presence given their dimensions, but there is a significant difference in their design languages. The Fortuner is sharper and more butch looking, while the Alturas has a softer, more elegant stance. The Alturas is also longer, which makes it look shorter, though in reality it is slightly taller than the Fortuner. The Fortuner's headlamp design is aggressive, and the aggression is accentuated further by thick strips of chrome on either side of his grille. In comparison, the headlights and grille on the Alturas are simpler looking, but they do look eye-catching. The Fortuner's shoulder line has a sharp kink at the C-pillar, which adds more flair to the sides, while the Alturas uses sharp character lines above both wheel arches to the same effect. Similarly, the Fortuner's tail lights are positioned higher, which makes for a taller stance as compared to the Alturas. There's a significant difference in terms of the interior design of both SUVs too, and the Alturas here feels more modern and a lot more luxurious in comparison to the Fortuner. The quilted leather on the seats, the door panels and the dashboard here especially adds a lot to the interior design and makes it look a lot more appealing. And in fact, the overall layout of the cabin is such that you could easily mistake the Alturas for a far more expensive SUV. The choice of materials and surface finishes like the quilted leather and brushed metal make for a rich feel inside, along with the dual-tone color scheme for the seats. The 8-inch infotainment screen looks crisp and bright, which adds to the upmarket feel, while the center console looks classier than the Fortuner's. The instrument cluster in the Alturas is also the better-looking one thanks to its more modern design, as also the crisp-looking 7-inch display nestled in between, which offers lots of information. What's more, the Alturas also comes equipped with an electric sunroof, something the Toyota misses out on. The Fortuner's interiors feel a lot more functional in comparison, and while the layout and the design of the cabin is good, the Fortuner simply does not feel as luxurious as the Alturas from inside. The Fortuner's all-black interiors look sporty, but rob it of the sense of spaciousness. The design of the center console here is also a lot more basic, and while there's generous use of leather on the dash and center console both, the overall layout is not as appealing. The Fortuner does get an additional glove box over the Alturas though, which is a cooled one. Its instrument cluster also integrates a digital display, and while it offers ample information, the display is not very crisp to look at. The front seats in the Alturas feel more spacious and comfortable, especially when it comes to spending long hours behind the wheel. The Alturas also has a little party trick up its sleeve in the form of ventilated seats for the driver and front passenger. And this is a feature that will be appreciated a lot, especially in Indian summers. Moving on to the second row of seats, the Alturas has a longer wheelbase, which translates to better interior space, but the second row seat in the Alturas is fixed and does not slide forward or backwards, which could be a problem, but with that said, there's good amounts of legroom and knee room, so I'm not really missing that function. And with that said, there is a distinct highlight about this second row here, which is the fantastic recline angle.
Interestingly, the Fortuner offers you more legroom and knee room in the second row, and that's despite the fact that its wheelbase is over 100mm shorter. You can also slide this seat forward or backwards as you like, and apart from that, the seat back here reclines completely.
Both SUVs come equipped with a third row of seats, of course, and I just had to try them out. The third row in the Alturas is accessed by first flipping the second row seat back down and then pulling a second lever to lift the seat up. Ingress is relatively easy, and once in, the Alturas also offers slightly better headroom and knee room, but I cannot imagine adults spending too much time there. Third row AC vents in the Alturas are also placed rather oddly on the right side, which could restrict airflow in case there's more than one occupant at the back. Getting into the Fortuner's third row is a quicker affair, as a single lever flips the seat back down and lifts the seat up as well. Ingress is not as easy as the Alturas though, and once in, headroom and knee room are also more restricted. Ventilation for the third row is better though, as there's two roof-mounted air conditioning vents here. Now, buyers spending 40-odd lakh rupees on an SUV today look for a lot of features and creature comforts, and the Alturas betters the Fortuner in this department too. Apart from offering Apple CarPlay and Android Auto connectivity as standard, its 8-inch touchscreen also doubles up as a display for the 360-degree camera, which is a segment first. The 360-degree view comes on by default when you are in reverse gear, but you can also turn it on by using a dedicated switch whenever you like. And while we are on the topic, I also need to mention that the Alturas comes equipped with front parking sensors too, something the Fortuner misses out on. There's an easy ingress and egress function as well, again seen only in more expensive SUVs, which slides the driver's seat forward or backwards every time you're getting into or out of the Alturas. The fog lamps are LED units, which also double up as cornering lamps, which is a boon. The Fortuner, unfortunately, does not get any of these features. Second row occupants in the Alturas also get a dedicated USB slot to charge devices, while the Fortuner only gets a 12-volt socket. The digital display in the Alturas also doubles up as a digital speedometer, and you can choose from an array of designs for it and also turn the backlight for the analog tachometer and speedometer off if you like. The very same display also integrates a tire pressure monitoring system, a feature the Fortuner does not get either. That said, the Fortuner does get dedicated controls for the second and third row air conditioning vents, along with more effective roof-mounted vents, whereas the Alturas only gets smaller vents integrated into the central front armrest.
When it comes to opening the boot, I don't have to do anything to open the boot of the Alturas. I simply stand behind the SUV with the key in my pocket, and the boot opens itself. But that is not the case with the Fortuner. The Fortuner requires me to pull the key out of my pocket, press the button here, and that's when the boot opens. The Fortuner is powered by a 2.8-litre four-cylinder diesel engine that offers 177 PS and 450 Nm of torque. The Alturas, on the other hand, uses a smaller 2.2-litre diesel engine that offers 180 PS and 420 Nm of torque. The Fortuner engine comes mated to a 6-speed automatic, while the Alturas uses a 7-speed automatic sourced from Mercedes-Benz. So on the powertrain front, both SUVs are pretty closely stacked. Despite having a smaller engine that makes lesser torque, the Alturas is the quicker of the two SUVs when it comes to acceleration, be it from standstill or through the gears, and that's something that was confirmed by a V-Box acceleration test. The Alturas engine is also smoother and a lot more refined than the Toyota engine, which makes for a quieter in-cabin experience on the go, which is also courtesy of the excellent insulation in this SUV.
A lot of credit for the sprightly feel offered by the Alturas engine is courtesy its significantly lower curb weight as compared to the Fortuner, as also the Mercedes-Benz sourced gearbox, which is quicker to respond to throttle inputs and puts engine power down better. And with that said, it is interesting to note that the Alturas was over a second quicker than the Fortuner in a 0-100 kmph acceleration test. As far as fuel efficiency is concerned, the two SUVs are on par with each other though, and return near similar figures in our city and highway efficiency tests.
The Fortuner's engine feels noisier in comparison as it has a constant clatter throughout the rev range, which is typical of a diesel engine, apart from which, as you build revs, there's a bit of a noise from the intercooler as well. I feel the cabin insulation in the Fortuner could have also been better, as there's a lot of the engine noise that creeps into the cabin, especially when you're going faster on open roads. The Fortuner's engine also feels slow to respond to throttle inputs, but I feel that has more to do with the gearbox rather than the engine performance itself. In fact, every time you take your foot off the throttle, the engine goes into a bit of a coast mode, which means that you do not have any engine braking.
That was all about how the SUVs drive on tarmac though. Now let's talk about their off-roading abilities. Both SUVs come equipped with proper four-wheel drive systems that let you select four-low mode via rotary knobs, so switching from two-high to four-high and then to four-low is an easy affair in either SUV.
But the Fortuner's ratios are lower, allowing it to crawl at slower speeds and also making for better load-pulling capacities. So if another vehicle were to get stuck off-road, I'd pick the Fortuner over the Alturas to pull it out.
It is not without reason that the Fortuner is a huge favorite amongst off-roaders. The second generation Fortuner has been an even bigger hit in that sense, and is revered across the country as one of the most capable SUVs when it comes to mud plugging. It clearly betters the Alturas in this department with its high approach and departure angles, which coupled with its low ratios and crawl speeds afford greater control and stability. The Alturas G4 though is not far behind, and in fact, its throttle response is smoother than the Fortuner's, which feels jerky in comparison. In terms of ride quality, the Alturas has the upper hand though, as it feels plusher going over bumps and potholes. The very same suspension setup also helps it feel more planted and more comfortable at high speeds on the highway as compared to the Fortuner. The Fortuner's suspension setup is softer than the Alturas, which helps it off-road, but on tarmac, the suspension feels noisy as it is a little too soft, and every time you go over a bump or pothole, you're constantly wiggling in your seat. Just like this. The Fortuner does not feel as planted or composed as the Alturas when it comes to cruising on open roads due to its soft suspension. In fact, it feels a little too sensitive to bumps and undulations at times, which robs it of a comfortable ride. But when it comes to handling, the Fortuner claws back some advantage by way of its steering system, which apart from offering better feedback, also feels more weighted in keeping with its large size. I also like the Fortuner's seating position better, as you sit taller in it than in the Alturas. The Fortuner has proved to us yet again why it is the best-selling SUV in its segment, and a lot of it has to do with its build quality and reliability. In fact, this very Fortuner that you see here has clocked over 35,000 kilometers, but neither does it look like it, nor does it drive like it. The Fortuner is also the most serious off-roader here, and that's one thing that helps it find favors with people who love to go off-road. But the Mahindra Alturas G4 is definitely the better package overall. It pampers you a lot more with an even more elaborate feature list as compared to the Fortuner. It feels spacious, feels luxurious, and the engine and gearbox are refined enough to make it feel quieter on the go. That is a lot going for it. But what really tilts the scales in the favor of the Mahindra here is the fact that it costs almost 4 lakh rupees lesser than the Fortuner, and that is a lot of money. Well, it remains to be seen how the Alturas will age in comparison to the fantastic Fortuner, but as far as the winner of this comparison test is concerned, it has to be the Mahindra Alturas.
Very exciting time to be in the market to buy a car, because there are so many choices that are coming our way, starting from BS6 cars to plug-in hybrids, electrics, autonomous cars, hatchbacks, sedans, crossovers, as well as premium cars. There is plenty to choose from. So here's our list of cars that are coming our way in 2019. Kicking off the four-wheeler bunch is India's biggest four-wheeler manufacturer, Maruti Suzuki. The original Tallboy, the Wagon-R, is expected by the end of this month. We reckon this tall boy will be priced at 4 lakh rupees. There's also a Wagon-R EV on the horizon, which is expected to have a 200 km drive range and a single charge. This is expected in India late this year or early in 2020 and might cost you 10 lakh rupees. Just before wrapping up 2018, M&M released the official teaser of its upcoming sub 4 meter SUV based on the SsangYong Tivoli, the XUV 300. It's going to be M&M's rival to the hot-selling Maruti Suzuki Vitara Brezza, and in all likelihood will be powered by the 1.5-litre diesel engine borrowed from the Marazzo. It should be priced between 7.5 to 10 lakh rupees and is expected to launch in February this year. This new year, Tata Motors' focus seems to be on all things premium. And going in line with that vision, we expect the premium hatchback based on the beautiful 45X concept showcased to us at the Auto Expo last year. Tata Motors should be ready to launch this car by the latter half of this year, and it will go up against the Maruti Suzuki Baleno. We expect this hatchback to be priced at around 5.5 lakh rupees going up to 8 lakh rupees. The 10th generation of the facelifted Honda Civic is in the pipeline for this year. The sedan will come with a new 1.6-litre diesel engine as in the CR-V and the familiar 1.8-litre petrol engine. With a prospective pricing of 16 to 21 lakh rupees, we expect the sedan to hit India by the first half of 2019. Toyota is expected to bring in the 8th generation Camry early this year. In the 40 lakh rupee price bracket, the Camry will be more spacious given it's also based on the Lexus ES300h platform. We are expecting quite a lot from this electric-only 2.5-litre plus electric motor powertrain. We saw it as the H5 X concept first a year ago. And since its showcase at the Auto Expo, Tata Motors has ensured we are awaiting the launch of its newest product in the premium compact SUV segment, the Tata Harrier. Only available with a 2-litre diesel in two-wheel drive and with a manual gearbox, all eyes are on the launch slated to take place this month. We expect the SUV to slot between the 14 to 21 lakh rupee price bracket. Nissan's premium alternative to the Terrano for the Indian market, the Kicks is expected to launch this month as well. Bookings of the SUV began last month, and the SUV is expected to fall between the 9.5 to 14.5 lakh rupees price range. At this price point, it will lock horns with the Hyundai Creta. The familiar 1.5-litre diesel and petrol engines continue to do duty under the hood, while it gets fully modern infotainment and features to sweeten the deal. Seen as the SP concept at the Auto Expo, this Creta-based rival will introduce India to Kia, the Korean sister brand of Hyundai. With edgier exteriors and plusher interiors, the Tusker or Trazer should offer an ever-so-polished experience to what the Creta offers, considering it shares engine options with the Creta. We expect the 1.6-litre petrol and diesel versions to come to India by May 2019. This SUV should be priced between the 10 to 15 lakh rupee price range. We've been smitten by its beauty and driven the third generation S60 last year and are eagerly awaiting its launch sometime this year. Volvo is most likely to bring in the T8 plug-in hybrid model, in which the T6's twin-charged engine is complemented by a 65 kilowatt electric motor for a combined output of over 400 PS. The hybrid propulsion ensures better driving range or fuel economy than an equivalent diesel, while being cleaner and greener. We expect Volvo to price this sedan in the 31.64 lakh rupees price range. The most advanced Mercedes-Benz on roads in mid-2019 will not be the S-Class, but the new GLE. Completely re-engineered, the GLE will debut a range of new engines, a third row of seats and advanced suspension technology, apart from cabin tech. At an expected 85 lakh rupees, we expect this SUV to launch in August this year. And finally, we are eagerly awaiting the first coupe SUV from Audi. It becomes the SUV flagship over the Q7, which it essentially is under its skin. Thankfully, future Q models will have more styling cues derived from it than the Q7. We believe it will be launched in India by mid-2019 and will be priced at the 1 crore rupee mark.
Overdrive. Now, 2019 seems to be a very good year for two-wheelers as well. Starting from scooters to adventure tourers to sports bikes, there are so many launches slated for this calendar year, so you can already start saving for that new bike.
There's a new and improved Bajaj Dominar set to launch in mid-2019. This motorcycle promises to fix all the niggles that the previous had, and the engine is expected to be more refined and make more power with the DOHC setup. The front forks will be USD like the ones you get on the KTM Dukes and the RCs. The bike could also get ride-by-wire and an improved LCD display. Prices may go up by 15 to 20,000 rupees. The entry-level adventure tourer category will see the X-Pulse 200 and the X-Pulse 200T, the street-biased version of the X-Pulse, going on sale by mid-2019. Prices are expected to be around the 1 to 1.1 lakh rupee mark. The X-Pulse 200T sits 30 mm lower than the 200, has taller gearing, different handlebar and seat. It also gets a 17-inch front wheel and a different tune for the front suspension. We'll be right back.
The new KTM 790 Duke could just be the perfect setup for the current crop of 390 Duke owners. While the design language is as radical as the other members of the Duke family, a brand new 105 PS and 86 Nm 799cc liquid-cooled parallel twin motor promises explosive performance. We expect a good price. The 2019 version of the RC390 will feature cosmetic as well as mechanical changes. The new model will have a reprofiled fairing and windscreen with improved aerodynamics. Expect a TFT instrument panel similar to the one on the KTM 390 Duke. We believe KTM will launch the motorcycle at the EICMA show in Milan during the latter half of this year, and India launch should follow soon thereafter. The new Katana revives a popular moniker that Suzuki first introduced in 1981. Based on Suzuki's GSXS series motorcycles, it will get the legendary K5 inline 4 engine that develops 152 PS. The iconic fairing incorporates a retro-styled rectangular LED headlamp, and the overall look is more butch than the original. We expect this motorcycle to make it to our shores by sometime around mid-2019. The CBR650R is a radical departure from its almost staid predecessor, be it in terms of looks or performance. The CBR1000RR Fireblade-inspired fairing looks aggressive, while the 95 PS inline 4 engine and reduced weight contributes to better power-to-weight ratio. We expect this motorcycle to be on sale in the first half of this year. Ducati says that the new generation Diavel builds on the strong foundations of its predecessor. The new Testa Stretta DVT 1262 engine is capable of producing 159 PS and 129 Nm of torque. The new Diavel is sleeker and has a new trellis frame, while the sportier S version of the Diavel 1260 features fully adjustable Olin suspension at both front and rear, dedicated wheels and Ducati Quick Shift Evo DQS as standard to allow clutchless shifting. Expected to go on sale sometime mid-2019. Multistrada 1260 Enduro is the hardcore off-road biased version of the incredible Multistrada 1260S. Changes include 10mm lower seat height and 30mm lower handlebars. The 1262cc Testa Stretta V-twin engine produces 85% of its peak torque below 3500 rpm, and the clever electronics along with dual-purpose Pirelli Scorpion Trail 2 tyres, ensuring good off-road capability. By mid-2019, we will also see the hyper-motard 950 from Ducati, which has a new 937cc Testa Stretta L-twin motor that makes 114 PS of power and 95 Nm of torque. A Bosch 6-axis IMU with cornering ABS and slide-by-brake function headlines the electronics package, while the SP variant with increased travel Olins and Marchesini forged wheels simply ups the ante. Come mid-2019, Yamaha will be launching the YZF R3 in India. As is the case with the new crop of R-series motorcycles, the new R3 also looks like a scaled-down version of the YZF R1. New KYB 37mm USD forks are expected to contribute towards better handling without compromising on comfort. The 321cc liquid-cooled parallel twin is the same as seen in the previous motorcycle, except it makes more power. Finally, coming our way by the year end for over an estimated 30 lakh rupees is the BMW S1000RR. With this motorcycle, the German manufacturer aims to gain liter class supremacy, and to do so, it's packed in an all new powertrain that puts out 209 PS of max power and 113 Nm of max torque. The new flex frame is slimmer and lighter by 1.3 kg with the engine as the stressed member.
the list of two-wheelers coming into the market this year also is pretty long, but you can check out the entire list on overdrive.in. On that note, we've run out of time on this week's episode of Overdrive, but remember, stay in touch with the team through Facebook, Twitter, as well as Instagram, and watch our latest videos on our YouTube channel. We'll see you next week. Until then, goodbye, and many thanks for watching.